Chapter 1. The Teddy Bears Arrive. The crate in which the teddy bears had journeyed from their birthplace in the factory to the big department store to which they were consigned had at last arrived at its final destination and was being unpacked, much to the delight of its occupants. For, as everybody who has ever traveled much knows, it is uncomfortable enough to journey packed so tightly in tissue paper and excelsior that one cannot move even as much as a whisker. But to make the whole trip standing on one's head is infinitely worse. And this had really happened to several of the teddy bears. But at last, all their troubles and discomforts had come to an end. Deft hands carefully unpacked them. Their coats were brushed until they shone. Their limbs, which of necessity had become more or less cramped, were carefully straightened, and their heads tilted at the most approved angle. Some of them were dressed in delightful worsted sweaters and peaked toboggan caps, each having a long tassel that hung over at the side, and there were also the cutest woolen leggings to match. Others were arrayed in little cotton overalls and a few in the most fascinating pajamas. Most of them, however, wore only their own furry coats, and very fine indeed they looked after the brushing and grooming. Their toilets having been completed, they were carried out to Department A, where all the toys were displayed, and Department A was indeed one of the most important sections of the whole store. It occupied the central portion directly in front of the big glass doors, and its wares were temptingly displayed in several of the great windows. In one of these had been built a roomy cage with white enameled bars, just such a cage as one sees at the zoo, only much handsomer. And in this the teddy bears were placed, each one posed in a most lifelike and natural manner and made to look as inviting as possible. Some were arranged to climb up the bars. Others were playing with balls, and two jolly little white fellows, as much alike as two peas, were swinging from a hanging trapeze. By the time all this was completed, it was very late indeed. All the lights were lowered, except those in the windows, and they seemed to shine brighter than ever by contrast with the surrounding darkness. The window dresser gave one or two final touches to his work and hurried off, grumbling that he would be very, very late for supper. The other clerks had already disappeared. The night watchman arrived with his dinner pail, and everything was left tight and trim until morning. For a long time, everything was very quiet indeed, for you must know that well-regulated toys never come to life until living creatures are fast asleep, for they can then pursue their pranks and gambols to very much better advantage. But presently a kind of long sigh ran through Department A, and in another moment a perfect babble of sounds arose and swelled upon the air. There was the mooing of cows, the bleating of woolly sheep, the crying of baby dolls, the choo-choo of iron steam cars. Suddenly the French walking doll, who had never been known to walk a step in the daytime unless she was wound up with a key, made a frantic spring from her box on the highest shelf, and landing lightly on her toes, came dancing and pirouetting down the center aisle, lightly swaying from side to side, now this way, now that, onward she came. And then bedlam broke loose. The big auto that had stood patiently all day right in front of the middle door started up a fearful tooting of its Gabriel horn, and dashing madly and wildly down a side aisle, came very near upsetting the big Noah's Ark, from whose door the occupants were streaming, led by Mr. Noah and his family. In one corner, a whole regiment of leaden soldiers began to drill by companies.
"Company, attention! Present arms! Order arms! Parade, rest!"
The little lead captain's voice rang out bravely. To be sure, it was somewhat husky, but then he might have somehow taken cold, for the weather was severe and Department A very badly heated at night. It should have been a competitive drill, but after a little the lead soldiers became impatient. They all wished to maneuver at once. It grew impossible to hear any of the commands, although the captain shouted until he was red in the face. The confusion was terrible. Now a great growling of lions and tigers and trumpeting of elephants arose from the shelf where the big menagerie stood. In vain the keeper rushed about, wielding his long whip. But who cares a snap for a keeper when he is made of wood and only about 6 inches high? Not the animals, not they. They would have torn each other to pieces had not their attention been suddenly attracted by the ascension of a big fire balloon that had been left over from 4th of July and forgotten. The balloon did very well, considering, until it reached the ceiling, where it stuck and caught fire. Here indeed was a serious situation. The balloon flamed furiously, and the paper dolls, who were located close by, set up a terrible shrieking, which was promptly joined in by all the other toys. Goodness only knows how the affair would have culminated had not the Iron Hook and Ladder Company just then come dashing down the aisle, closely followed by the chemical engine and the lofty water tower. It was the work of but a few seconds to set up the tall ladders, and every one of the fainting paper dolls was carried to a place of safety by the gallant cast-iron fire laddies. To be sure, the paper dolls were many, many times taller than their brave rescuers, but then they were so light in weight that their greater height did not make the smallest particle of difference. In the midst of all the hullabaloo, the bears suddenly realized that they, too, were alive, and came swarming and scurrying out of their cage, which, fortunately for them, had been built without a top, tumbling over each other in their anxiety to be first in the scrimmage. Their appearance tended somewhat to calm matters down, as all the other toys were anxious to meet the newcomers, and came crowding around, shaking hands in a very friendly way. All except the lead soldiers, who were all in the guardhouse, having been ordered thither for insubordination. The big woolly ram with gilt horns even went so far as to apologize for the absence of order, which indeed was putting it mildly. As for himself, he had remained quietly in his place, only giving vent occasionally to a vigorous baa in order to testify to his disapproval of the general roughhouse. Indeed, he was the oldest toy in the store, having been on exhibition for 2 successive Christmases, being too large and expensive to find a purchaser readily, but was always accorded the most prominent position in the showcase, as he proudly informed the largest of the bears. Whereupon the bears tossed their heads, wondering what was the matter with their own position. Just then one of the paper dolls, a bride, was found to be in a hysterical condition. The poor thing had just discovered that all her beautiful trousseau had been destroyed in the conflagration. Restoratives were applied at once, and it was proposed to take up a collection among the toys for her benefit. but at that critical moment a sound, high and shrill, smote upon the ears of all. It was the crowing of the mechanical cock, whose duty it was to inform the others of the approaching dawn. In an instant all was quiet, and every one in his place. Only the toboggan cap of one of the bears, pulled off in the struggle, lay on the floor, where it was picked up next morning by the floor walker, who arrived first on the scene, and who ever after regarded the night watchman with suspicion. And the queerest part of the whole story is that the night watchman never heard a single sound during the whole performance. Chapter 2, which introduces Sally. The teddy bears sold like hotcakes. Never before had any one toy called forth such a demand. And it really seemed as if every Christmas tree in the town was destined to be decorated with at least two or three of the quaint little brown creatures. One afternoon, a smart little electric car stopped in front of the big department store. Out of it stepped a fashionably gowned woman, and after her sprang out a plump little girl with round rosy cheeks, a pair of round blue eyes, and a little red mouth that she was in the habit of screwing up into a round O whenever she wanted a kiss, which was quite often. Her brown velvet coat came down to the bottom of her pretty frock, and her big brown hat was trimmed with soft, fluffy plumes. Her bright hair was braided in two long tails and tied with soft, wide ribbons. Altogether, she was such a comfortable, roly-poly of a girl that it really seemed as if she might roll off like a ball, should anyone give her a push. People looking after her smiled involuntarily, as she, herself smiling, disappeared through the revolving door of the shop. Of course, the teddy bears claimed her immediate attention. She hung over their cage, uttering little exclamations of eagerness and delight. And the conclusion of the whole affair was that Mama selected a whole family instead of just one teddy bear, as she had at first intended. She ordered them to be wrapped at once and carried out to the auto, and her little daughter could scarcely wait until they reached home, so eager was she to play with her new treasures. Arrived at the house, it did not take very long to unwrap the teddy bears and set them up, all in a row, in the wide window seat of the nursery. There was Papa Bear, round and jolly, Mama Bear, plump and comely, a pair of twins so much alike that you really could not tell one from the other, and a wee baby bear so dear and cunning that Sally could not refrain from giving it a frantic hug and a kiss. When bedtime came, she insisted on taking the Papa Bear to bed with her, having first comfortably tucked up all the rest of the family in one of her doll's cribs, much to the discomfiture of the doll to whom it belonged. For she was left, neglected, to sit up all night by herself in a corner of the sofa. For a while everything was very quiet in the nursery. The nightlight burned dimly in its pretty vase of rosy crystal, showing Sally as she lay fast asleep and breathing softly, the braids of her bright hair lying loosely on the pillow, and one little plump hand holding fast the teddy bear's soft and somewhat resisting paw. But presently, something under the bedclothes stirred at first gently, then more vigorously. A little moving heap edged its way out from under the sheets and blankets, and a queer little brown figure in pink striped pajamas shook itself free and stood up by Sally's pillow. The Papa Bear was wide awake, ready for action, and very anxious to explore his new surroundings. Besides being very much awake, he was beginning to develop a rousing appetite, for of necessity he had been forced to fast since the night previous, when he and his family had feasted royally at the candy counter in Schwartz's. Very cautiously, he swung himself to the floor and trotted over to the crib that contained his family. They were all wide awake and all as hungry as hunters. Like the good provider that every father of a family should be, Papa Bear immediately set out on a voyage of discovery. The nursery door was open, but the room beyond, in which Dr. and Mrs. North slept, was so dark and quiet that Mr. Bear resolved to confine his still hunt to the nursery. Round and round he trotted, sniffing at everything which looked as if it might be good to eat. Several times he was cruelly deceived and presented in turn to his rapacious family a fat red tomato that proved to be stuffed with sawdust and full of little shining, sharp-pointed things that he later found out were called pins, a beautiful red-cheeked pear that turned out to be made of wax, and a bunch of plump purple grapes that had, in the beginning, been destined to adorn nurse's best bonnet, and were, in consequence, singularly dry and unappetizing. Farther investigation, however, was rewarded by the discovery of a box of delicious champagne wafers, put away on the closet shelf for Sally's especial delectation. Delighted with this find, the hungry bears soon emptied the box, which Mrs. Bear immediately utilized as a seat for the baby cub. Having thus satisfied his own appetite and leaving his family comfortably chewing, Papa Bear now started forth on a tour of investigation. He had learned a thing or two during his stay in the department store, and one of them was that if a place is dark and you wish to light it up, the very easiest way to do so is to press a little button in the wall. So he trotted around the nursery, carefully looking along the wall for such a button. Before very long he found it, close to Sally's bed, and quite within his reach if he climbed up on the pillow, which he was not at all slow to do. And then, in less time than it takes to tell it, his brown paw was fumbling with a button, and in a second the room was flooded with brilliant light. This so annoyed the nightlight that she flew into a temper and immediately went out, which, however, did not make the smallest difference as far as anybody else was concerned. Mr. Teddy Bear was so overjoyed by the success of his experiment that he immediately began to dance a jig, and all the other teddy bears promptly followed his example. They were all feeling fine after their luscious meal, and no doubt also felt the need of some exercise, as they had been asleep for at least 24 hours. Mrs. Bear had espied a doll's piano and immediately sat down at it and commenced to play a waltz. Now, a bear's idea of waltz music is not just what boys and girls would consider very musical, besides which Mrs. Bear had never touched a piano before in all her life. However, her ear was tolerably correct, and the result of her efforts was more than satisfactory to her admiring family. By this time the rest of the toys were awake, and the bears were delighted to discover several old friends from Schwartz's. Merrier and merrier grew the music, and faster waxed the dance, as all the toys immediately seized upon the nearest partners and whirled them off to trip the light fantastic. A truly comical sight it was to see the baby bear waltzing with the French doll, whose place in bed he had usurped, while the twins led off, one with a jolly, round-eyed rag doll, who had come all the way from London, as she proudly informed her partner, and the other with a wooden soldier, who had lost one leg and consequently hopped about in a most absurd manner. The twin, however, being far too polite to discard him for a more acceptable partner, kept on dancing until the wooden soldier was obliged to stop from sheer exhaustion. Suddenly, a sound from the bed caused everyone to look in that direction. And what did they see but Sally, wide awake and staring at them with eyes full of perplexity and amazement. Chapter 3, In Which the Teddy Bear Finds a Name. In a moment, everything had become quiet. Sally sat up in bed, rubbing her eyes, and quite unable to believe the evidence of her own senses. For how could a rational little girl be expected to believe that a teddy bear was really standing beside her bed, bowing to her politely, and pausing between bows?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.